For those of you who don't know, my name is Stephen Dolan. I've probably emailed or Facebooked to every single person in this room, including the Tajikistani delegation, more times than I might have wanted to. Congratulations on surviving Ireland's visa process, Dublin Airport, the bus to Galway, and registration. You guys are in for a great 2 weeks. We're really looking forward to seeing you debating in the World Cup Hockey Championships, then mixing you all up for the KP tournament, mixing you all up for the MTT, getting you all back together for another competition, and more importantly, making sure that you, like everyone else who's attended the Global Youth Forum, go away with a group of friends that you never thought you could possibly have before, with names that you probably can't pronounce now, and people from countries that you thought only existed in films. You'll recognise our forum staff, and we'll introduce them to you all later, but if you've got any questions, you can come and find us. After we get through the opening ceremony tonight, we're going to run a couple of announcements about the debating tomorrow, so please don't leave. And without very much further ado, I'd like to introduce Mr. Marcin Zaleski, the Executive Director of the of Idea UK.
Hi guys, this is my, believe you or not, I shouldn't be saying this because that's going to make me sound and look very old. This is my 19th forum. I know. Be more cheerful. I remember the first forum in Hungary, in Tata, a little lake resort near Budapest. I was then a baby teacher. I taught English at a Polish school, and I brought my team to that forum in 1995. And I'll tell you what, it was a much smaller room when we were doing our opening ceremony. We had, I think we had about 50 people and about 10 countries represented. And back then, we never believed that it's going to grow to this forum. I've been told it's 58 countries represented. So we've done well over the years. And I've done a few of those opening ceremonies in the past, as you can imagine, and I'm trying to always find something new and intriguing about each and every forum and the country that it's hosted in. And I've been thinking about Ireland, and this is the first English-speaking country that we've done the forum. So when you go out, you should not have, at least in theory, any problems communicating with the local community. Now, what can I tell you about the Irish? And I'll explain to you in a minute why I'm the authority on the subject. They're the most lovely, welcoming, fun people that I know, and I'm speaking from personal experience. My wife is Irish, and two of my little daughters are Irish, and I love them, and they're great fun, and they changed my life, and I'm sure that you guys, the next 2 weeks over here in Ireland, you will never forget this time here. The forum is about debates, and it's that's what you'll be doing most of the time. You figure that given how much the forum costs, and how much it costs you to fly over here, we want to make sure that you spend your time productively. The forum and the debate that we do here is different for those of you who are here for the first time, and you'll find out why, particularly when you join the mixed team tournament. As far as I can tell, this is the only debate event in the world where debaters from different countries, different languages, different cultures, come together on teams and debate each other in this international setting. This is what makes the forum unique. it creates incredible friendships, it creates an incredible learning experience and environment. People learn about different facts of, and Steve has mentioned, you know, countries that you've never heard of before. But you, as you become friends and as you prepare for the debate, you find out what a unique experience this is, and I hope that we'll be able to keep it this way for a long time to come. Just to finish this little intro to the forum, it is about debating, but it's also about those little moments outside of debate, when you're walking from the Karen village to the canteen to have your lunch and talking about stuff. It's when you take a break from debating. It's when you go and play soccer or tennis, or when you socialize, when you go to the cinema, when you go out. This is what makes the forum unique. And as much as someone who is responsible for all the funding, and I need to report to the funders and donors that you spend your time debating, I would also like to encourage you just become friends and use this time to have a great experience. And I hope that it's going to be a great time. Enjoy it. This is a great place and this is a great event. Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much, Martin. We're very lucky to have a distinguished keynote speaker with us this evening. To list Marian Harkin's achievements would probably be a little bit too difficult for me to do, but she is more than once the winner of the MEP of the Year poll. She is my, well, not mine now because I live in London, but she is my MEP because I'm a Galway boy and you never move out of Galway. But much more importantly than that, Marian is a former debate coach who has coached teams who have beaten teams that I have coached in debate competition. So I hold absolutely no grudges. But I'd like to introduce this to you, Ms. Marian Harkin.
Thank you very much. Well, thank you very much for that kind introduction. I didn't actually know that I coached teams that beat teams that you coached. But anyway, there's nothing wrong with that. So first of all, I just want to say that I'm absolutely delighted to have the opportunity to say welcome to all of you to Galway this evening and for the next 10 days. I know from reading your agenda that you're in for a very exciting, interesting and informative time. And I think during this time you will have the opportunity to explore new ideas and to debate and discuss some very relevant and topical issues. And while I think debating is core to what's going on, I suspect that many of you will learn as much just by listening as well as by talking. And by that I don't mean that you absorb other people's ideas, but that you have an opportunity to expand and enrich your own. Because in some ways we live in a global village, but in other ways this is still a very vibrant, exciting world. And I think over the next few days, all of you will have the opportunity to expand your worldview and to broaden that tunnel vision that constrains very many of us. And I'm a member of the European Parliament, and one of the positives of working in the European Parliament is that you begin to understand context in a way that would not be possible if you just remained in Ireland. No history book, no learned appreciation of either culture or art, no knowledge of a foreign language can give you the same thing as being there, and that gives you context. And that, whether you like it or not, can change your views. It mightn't be an earthquake, it just might be a minor tremor, but it can shift the way you think. And I think over the next 10 days, all of you will have that opportunity to shape the debate, to influence during the discussion, and to learn from others. And as a former participant, and I'll get this name wrong, I know, but Debbie Ubit from Mongolia said, he said, I was so deeply inspired to grow and challenge myself to be better. So participants from 40 countries And I think 18 other countries of trainers, etc., have gathered here in Galway. You may not know it, but Galway in Ireland is known as the city of the tribes. And in one fell swoop, you have probably increased the number of tribes in Galway by 100%. But Galway is a very welcoming city, a city where there's a confluence of art, culture, tradition, heritage, the Irish language, where they blend together to produce a very Gaelic city. No, I don't say an Irish city, I say a Gaelic city. Yet, it's a very cosmopolitan and outward-looking place. I read recently that the city in Ireland with the highest percentage of resident non-nationals is not the capital city, Dublin, it's Galway. So that tells you something about Galway. It tells you about its attraction and its lure of this really beautiful place. Now, I envy you over the next few days because you have the opportunity to gain a real understanding of the different and often conflicting issues surrounding the vexed question of internet freedoms. And reading one of the background papers where it described a specific case on the issue of internet freedom, what it said was this. It said, this case raises many questions and provides very few easy answers. And the reason that I envy you is that more and more parliamentarians have to put forward amendments on proposals, on guidelines, and even on legislation on digital rights and freedoms. And to do that, we have to be well informed so that we can properly assess the different options and outcomes, and crucially, that we have some idea of the impact of our decisions on citizens. And a recent example in the European Parliament, and I give this example because I think many of you will be aware of it or have heard of it, is the discussions on something called the ACTA Agreement, which is the Anti-Counterfeiting Trade Agreement. I suspect many of you will have heard of that because I received emails from almost every country in the world on that particular issue. But this, for those of you who aren't fully aware of it, was a proposed multinational treaty for the purpose of establishing international standards for intellectual property rights and enforcement. Basically, a number of countries, the US, Canada, Australia, Japan, and others, came together and they tried to draw up an international legal framework to target counterfeit goods, generic medicines, and copyright infringement on the internet. That sounds reasonable. But fears over fundamental rights infringements and over access to medicines in developing countries, and fears about the cloak of secrecy surrounding the negotiations and the exclusions of basically all non-government actors from the negotiations, along with, as I said, a huge global campaign, led to the defeat of that proposal in the European Parliament. And so, the European Union cannot ratify that treaty. Now, for many of us as parliamentarians, that was a difficult decision. Do you reject an agreement because of how it was negotiated? You might object strongly to the process, and I did, but you've got to look at content as well as process. How do you balance the pluses and the minuses? If we don't have enforceable copyright laws, will that stifle creativity and innovation? But on the other hand, there was a real fear that the agreement could slow down or even stop the supply of cheaper generic medicines to developing countries. So these are some of the challenges at the heart of decision making. And as our world becomes more complicated, as black and white often merge to grey, as truth is very often not absolute, just somebody's version of the story, and as more and more voices clamour to be heard, and sometimes as forensic evidence clashes with the needs of local communities, how do you assess not so much the best option, but the better option? And that's what you're going to be involved in over the next few days. Assessing the evidence, teasing through the arguments and putting forward your positions. And in all of that, I wish you well. But one of the ideas that impressed me regarding your deliberations over the next few days, and again I read it in the blurb that I was sent, was that you will be facilitated in becoming active citizens. And I think even more important than that, informed active citizens. Now, I'm a politician. I often call myself an accidental politician because I actually came into politics by accident. Nobody in my family was ever in politics. There was no tradition. And I come from the voluntary sector, but I've ended up in politics. But perhaps because I've come from the voluntary sector, I place a great deal of emphasis on participative democracy. And I believe that that works alongside representative democracy. And I think the internet facilitates participative democracy in that it democratizes information. And as we all know, information is power. And participative democracy to me is where we affect change by participating. Whether it's a global campaign on internet freedom or a local campaign to improve the quality of life of elderly people and everything in between. Last night, for example, I organised a meeting not too far away from here, about an hour away, on wind farms. Green, renewable energy sounds good. So, what do we need to worry about? Well, as it turned out, lots, actually. Turbines 184 metres high, dominating small communities. A couple, not far from here, having to leave their home because of noise that you can't hear. It's called infrasound. And last night, there were as many people in that room as there are here. And every single one of those people felt helpless in many ways because they couldn't influence the planning process. And local decisions were being overturned. But the crucial thing about last night, and the link to what you'll be doing over the next 12 days, is that all of those people used their access to the internet to source reports on everything from peer-reviewed medical studies on sleep deprivation that is linked to this infrasound from the wind turbines, to background decibel noise, to legislation that's governing environmental impact assessment. Ordinary citizens who found themselves in a situation they never thought they would be in, and they were able to use their access to the internet to try to influence what is happening. And now before I finish, I just want to mention one more issue that I care deeply about, and that issue is volunteering. And I just briefly want to mention how that is being impacted hugely by technological change. I was involved in a UN report on volunteering just 2 years ago. And in that report it states, the technological developments are opening up spaces for people to volunteer in ways that have no parallel in history. Volunteers can count on a rapidly growing range of technologies to help them tackle many of the pressing global issues. Everything ranging from tracking food security, to monitoring violent conflicts, from providing early warning of imminent disasters, to reporting election fraud, from activism in social media that has contributed to the overthrow of certain regimes, and to online volunteerism, for example, providing translation for free. At a personal level, timing, distance and location no longer matter. You can contribute from your office, from your home, in fact, from wherever you have a connection. And I suppose, at the end of the day, that's what it's all about. Having that connection. And making that connection allows you, and that connection to the internet, allows you to contribute. And thereby, you make a human connection. Because in some way, you improve a quality of life for somebody. So I hope that over the next few days here in Galway, your quality of life is enhanced, and that you leave Galway not necessarily a different person, but a person whose mind has been opened, whose experience has been broadened, and whose knowledge has expanded. And maybe, and I suspect you will, you'll make a few friends along the way. Earlier, I spoke of the attraction and the lure of this beautiful place of Galway. And all I'll say to you is this evening is feel it, taste it, smell it, absorb it, enjoy. Thank you.
Lastly, before we conclude the formal opening ceremony business, I just want to say, as a young man who is not that young anymore, but as a man who is fairly young, who was born across the road in the hospital, not in a house, he grew up about a 20-minute drive away, and he spent 6 years in my late teens and early 20s studying at this university. I agree with Marian that this is probably the most special city in Ireland. But I think that a major part of that is because of this university. And when we have the opportunity to find a host venue for the Global Youth Forum this year, there is no place that I could think of that would suit the place better than NUI Galway. And part of that is the man who is currently tasked with being, with drawing also the president of NUI Galway, and that's Dr. James Brown.
Thank you very much. The fall show up there, the girls going to hear in Galway, that certainly confused all of you, right? That's, Marian mentioned the city as the Gaelic city. That is correct. We are a bilingual university, and this university tries and supports to promote education through Irish. So I tend to use little bits of Irish in my speech and presentations. So, say again, a fall show up there, the girls going to hear in Galway, they're in Lara, Grant, even Shawalla, and Solway, and then I go in this very fine evening. I'm very happy to be here to welcome all of you to this very, very important forum. I want to welcome in particular our MEP, Marian Harkin, Marcel, who's a new friend of the university, Stephen, of course, is an old friend of the university, representatives from the various different debating societies, all of you who are involved in promoting the idea Global Youth Forum, the Open Society Foundation Youth Initiative, who are sponsoring your work. And I want to especially welcome the students who come here from, I'm not sure how many countries, but certainly in excess of 50 countries. You're all very welcome to this university, and I hope that you'll have a very enjoyable time here. Let me say a few words about the background to the university. The university goes back to 1845. That was a very critical time in Irish history, in the middle of the so-called Great Famine. And this part of the country was by far the most impacted by that famine. It's reckoned that the population was 8 million people prior to the 1840s. By the 1850s, we talked about 4.5 million. So the population more or less halved over 10 years. About 2 million died, and about 2 million left. And that's why we have such a strong connection with North America, Canada, United States, Argentina, surprisingly, also Australia, New Zealand. Because many of the people who are now Irish Americans, they go back to the people who left this country in the 1840s and later. But the amazing thing was that at that time, the then government, the British government in fact, the then part of Vancouver, they made a decision to create universities here. And picking this city, which at the time was absolutely poverty-stricken. There were roads. There were no roads in the city. Where we are now is outside the city. That's a little small the city was at the time. There were almost no stable houses. And yet the city was made to build a university here. And that university has in fact been, I would say, the saving of the rest of Ireland over the years. Because it started off as a very small institution, with about 70 students. If you have a chance to go and see the quadrangular building, which is about, I suppose, 200 yards from here, the oldest building of the campus, built in the 1840s, built on mountains on one of the Cambridge Gardens, and a very fine classical building, quadrangular, as I say, with obviously four sides, were built to a very fine architecture and still the sort of centre of the university in terms of our major small events at that university were small. You couldn't count as many people in the rooms in that part of the university. But it works in the future some sense of the place. Now we have 17,000 students in this institution, about 2,500 part-time about 14,500 full-time students. We also have 2,000 international students from 92 countries. That might surprise you, so many countries I've said to you. Some are very small numbers, admittedly, but big numbers from North America, from China, from Malaysia, from India, from the Arab countries, from the Middle Eastern countries, a lot of Europeans, obviously, mainland Europeans. But in total, about 2,000 of foreign students, meaning non-Irish students. So we're a very internationalized university, a very strong research intensive university with a lot of work going on in areas as diverse as biomedical engineering science, internet technologies. I know part of your interest here is digital technology. Part of your debate here is around that whole area, how we can have freedom and so on. This university is one of the largest internet technology sites in the world, mainly because of Ireland's huge investment in that area. A lot of the major multinational corporations who lead that whole industry, people like Google, people like Facebook, IBM, Apple, Hewlett Packard, Cisco, there's Postman Cook, all these companies, many are in this town. And that basically university is a very large research center in that space. Big area of human rights law is here, very important area. Environmental law, marine science, social sciences, and also digital humanities. The university is very strong on the whole area of taking humanities resources and digitizing them. Things like, for example, archives, major cable archives, trying to create material, content for the new telecomputing technologies. We have very many graduates from the university who have done very well. For example, the physicist, George Stoney. Those of you who are from Stan Physics know about the electron. The man who coined that term was George Stoney. He was a professor of this university. Alice Perry, the first engineer in the British Isles, possibly in the world, graduated from the 1910s. Many national leaders, our president, for example, Mike Higgins, is a Galway graduate. In fact, a former member of staff here. Lots of broadcasters, judges, journalists, actors, politicians, people like John McGovern, very famous Irish writer, Tom Kilroy, the Drew Theatre from obviously university, has done very well. So we have a very strong international linkages. We have links with many US universities, places like Stanford, places like Georgia Tech, Fordham in New York, also Chinese universities, places like Tsinghua University in Beijing, Harvard Institute of Technology up in Manchuria, and Qingdao University, one of the marine science universities in China. We're also part of the US European Coimbra Group. Coimbra is a group of European universities which go back to the 19th century and are traditionally being research intensive universities in cities outside of the capital cities. I think in your package of material you have information about the university, that might give you some sense of what we're doing here. I hope that you enjoy reading about it and learning about what's on offer here. Marian mentioned volunteering. This university also is very strong in that area. We adopted a model from North Carolina, United States about 10 years ago. And now every year we recognize about 500 students for their volunteering work. We recognize that through a formal ceremony where we certify it and reward those and recognize them what they've done. We also provide for service learning, where students can in fact learn by doing, as well as learning by traditional methods in terms of talk and talk and more modern virtual learning environments and so on. I think it's very good that you're in this country this particular year. As you know, it's the year of the gathering, it's the year when the Irish government have tried to attract as many people into Ireland as possible, gather back to our shores, people from the various countries in the world who have links with us. And it's good to have you here from that point of view, and it's certainly very fit that you should be here in this city at that time. Yours is a very important forum. I think it's tremendous for so many countries, so many people from different backgrounds, but also different ages and different sets of experiences. You do understand both experienced debaters and also young learning people who are trying to improve their learning skills. I hope all of you have a very good time, and I'm sure you'll enjoy your time here. I believe also local schools will be involved in this industry, that some local schools will participate in the program, and that most of what you do will also be live streamed to those schools. So I hope you have a chance to enjoy the city in your 2 weeks here, enjoy the university. Please try to see what we have, try and see the quadrangle inside, try to see our new buildings, try to have a look at our library, try to just get a sense of our facilities and what's on offer here. And as I say, I'm delighted to have you here. I hope that you, that in your time here, that you not only get that benefit in terms of enjoyment, but also you develop your own critical skills, your critical thinking skills, your debating skills, your ability to understand other cultures, your appreciation of academic excellence, appreciation of each point of views, and most of all, that you hone your own skills in debating and public speaking. You may not know this, but this university has a society which goes back to the very beginning, which promoted literary debating activity. Right back to the beginning of the university, we had a literary dev society, which meets, in fact, every Thursday night in a room not far from here. And that's a society which has a tremendous history. And just as a little anecdote about that, the present president of our, Mike Higgins, he was editor of it 50 years ago, in 1964. He gave the inaugural speech. And the inaugural speech that society in that year was the future of Ireland. We've invited him back next year, next academic year, to come back and tell us now as president how Ireland has done in the intervening 50 years. So we look forward to that. Those of you who know him or know of him will know he's a very fine debater, a very fine political lecturer, and no doubt that will be a tremendous lecture. But it's a tremendous link back to different dead in the university. And in fact, our colleague here, you were also part of different dead. So the different dead has a tremendous resonance in this university and certainly includes some very fine, amongst outgoing monitors, some very fine people. So with those few words, I again welcome you all to Galway, welcome to the university, hope you enjoy your time in the university and the city, and please make the best of it. Very marvelous. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Byrne. Unfortunately, I don't think in 50 years' time anyone's going to be inviting me back to repeat my inaugural address, why the West Wing is the best TV series currently available on streaming. Okay, so before we play you the forum song for the first of 1,072 times, just a couple of announcements about tomorrow. Firstly, we covered this at registration, but breakfast is from 8 to 9 a.m. All of the meals that you're going to have, except for one or two, which we'll tell you about when they're different, will be where you just had dinner. We've now brought you from accommodation to the restaurant once, so you're on your own. We don't care if you get lost. You end up outside Galway, your own fault. I'm joking, we will be running people back again from reception in the morning, but after that you are on your own. Also, the KP demonstration debate is going to take place just after that, and that's in the Curwen Lecture Theatre, which is just at the top of the stairs when you come out of the restaurant. Again, please follow the instruction from our trainers and staff as we get you up there tomorrow morning. How many people were in Mexico last year? How many people have managed to get mariachi loco out of your head yet? For those of you who have not been to an NUI youth forum before, we pick a forum song. That forum song is played at morning assembly every day. It is played at most of the social events. We will pipe it through the telephone system in your room should you so require. Tony has painstakingly typed out the lyrics so you can learn it. And I guarantee you, in 20 years' time, you'll wake up in the middle of the night screaming. It's actually quite difficult to pick a forum song for Ireland. We've got a rich history of traditional music, but unfortunately, most of the songs are either about dying in the famine, or dying in the civil war, or wanting to kill British people. Most inappropriately of all, a million and one different songs designed to be sung while you're drinking alcohol. That said, we have found an Irish song, and as all good Irish songs are, this is an Irish cover version of a song written by an American man who's never actually been to Galway. But hopefully you'll enjoy it. Please wait around after this because Manos has some announcements from the tavern and then we're going to let you guys go and get some well-earned sleep before you get up right nearly a clock time tomorrow for breakfast. That wasn't enthusiastic. Great, you can always remind the Galway lads to shout up the back of the next. Those are the Irish team, by the way. Congratulations, Ireland, for finally sending a team to the 19th Youth Forum. Maybe next year is a special 20th birthday present. England will bother to show up. But then they'll just take all their land at the table. So this is a confirmed song that I hope you enjoy. Let's talk on the 24th. Okay, can Manos, can I get you to come up? Manos is going to announce a couple of important things. Firstly, for the individual participants, what teams you're going to be in. Apologies for not being able to announce this earlier, but we have literally been reassigning you up until about 5 minutes before the opening ceremony started. Then we're going to give you the labs that you're going to be going into for the KP labs tomorrow after the demo division. Okay, so Manos.
Hello everyone and welcome to Galway, to this beautiful campus. Jurgen and myself have prepared everything for tomorrow, so hopefully the debating experience is going to be as good as everything else around here. A couple of brief announcements that we're going to run. First, there's a number of you that have registered as individual debaters, and it's time for you to find out who you'll be debating with. So I'd like you to stand up as you roll out your names. From Team 36, can we have Laura Eliana? Yeah. It's so funny, Laura. Jocelyn? And Ariana. Laura, did you stand up again? Laura? Stand up again. So, the three of you are in Team number 36. We haven't been really creative with those names yet. And your coach is Colin Rogers from Leather Mountain College. If you could also stand up. There you go. Now in Team 37, could we have Polly Todd? And Grandpa Edman. If you don't know, as Team 37 will be coached by our trainer, Stella Zuban. Woo-hoo! Bramley, Team 38, we have Koti Togisaka. Rebecca Highline. And Adriana Panay. Adriana may have not arrived yet, but she is negotiating her way down the doorway. And this team will be coached by Rona Little. So after the survey, get to meet your teammates, pick a new team name because ours doesn't really work. Now, there's also two teams that are registered with two speakers that we have found a third speaker for. So, Danny Petrak, Danny, are you here? Yes. Joins the Amsterdam Ignatius Debating Society team. They haven't arrived yet. Oh, there they are. Yeah. And Pavlina Pasvaeva. We'll be joining the team from the best school from neighboring Kazakhstan. Now, also, a couple of teams did not have coaches, so we have assigned coaches to those teams so that you can use them during your preparation, especially for the limited prep rounds. This is our list. So for Canada Humphrey, it will be Nevers from the Philippines. For Team Enders from Ireland, it will be Scott Thompson. For the second team from Kosovo, it will be Ronit Power. For the second team from Pakistan, it will be Novinik Voskan. For the team from Serbia, it will be Mark Woomsey. For the team USB from Tajikistan, it will be Ion Nasku. And for the team from Hunter, that's a favorite. Team from Hunter College, they are Markova. And team Taimai and friends, it will be Chris Sanchez. Cool. Now the last announcement we have to make today is which labs you're going to be in tomorrow morning while preparing for the World Cup Open Debate Challenges, after the demo debate. So, all five labs are named after Irish cities. First one, called Bandon. So, Bandon from nearby Cork. The teams in that lab will be Belarus, Estonia, Vesco, Yet Macedonia, Russia, St. Petersburg, USB, Texas, and Team 36. And the lab is after Cork. Canada, Ghana, Haiti, Kosovo 1, Amsterdam, Luanda, Tunisia 1, AXL 1A, and Team 37. Lab named Dublin. Canada Humphrey, Peets, Kosovo 2, Pakistan A, Serbia, Tunisia 2, AXLB, Team 38. Lab called Limerick, Canada Pearson, Enders, Yes We Can, Pakistan B, Slovakia, Counter, and Vietnam. And finally, Sligo, teams North America, Japan, Lithuania, Al-Zalil, Solidus Rock, Beaver, and Adelaide. That should be everything that we have here. We will be posting this up on the team listings and everything tomorrow morning so you can see it during breakfast. So I'll see you all tomorrow morning for the demo today with the WKBDC. Thank you.
That officially concludes the opening ceremony. If coaches can bring your teams back to Carr Village, trainers, if you can stay behind, because Rona, Georgi, and Malo want to have a word with you briefly. And everybody have a good night's sleep, and we'll see you at 8 a.m. for breakfast.